Dr. Green will present next on preventive genomics now. Dr. Green is a medical geneticist, a physician, and professor at Harvard Medical School. He is the associate director for research at Partners Personalized Medicine Program. Dr. Green also directs a very important genome to people research program in the division of genetics at Brigham and Women's Hospital and Harvard Medical School. He also currently co-chairs a steering committee of the newborn sequencing in genomic medicine program. Welcome, and we'd like to hear your ideas how to progress with all the amazing technologies and in genomics and computer science.
Thank you very much, Renata. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to convince you, this is very different than some of the other talks, I want to convince you that medical genomics has reached the point where we should be seriously considering sequencing all of you in order to improve your health in the future. Some of you are very futuristically oriented. You might actually think this is an old question, or maybe this question has already been asked and answered, or maybe, you know, why aren't we already doing it? Some of you have done consumer-facing genomics, and you're asking yourself, why is this even an issue? But I assure you that it is an issue in the medical world, and it's very controversial at this point. And there are forces aligned, some I think appropriate, some inappropriate. There are forces aligned against this that could delay it another 5, 10, 15 years. So in this short presentation, I'm going to try to convince you that we should all be working toward moving the ball forward in terms of preventive genomics. I do want to make sure you know my conflicts of interest and my support, which is largely from NIH, also the Department of Defense, the Broad Health System in South Dakota, and a fund in the name of Franco Cesani, and the companies that I advise, as well as a company that I have co-founded. So my program is actually a very small core program of about 25 individuals, but we've sort of mastered the art of collaboration with groups all over the country and the world. So the work I'm about to show you is not mine alone, not even our programs alone, but is our deeply collaborative teams of sometimes 100 investigators or more, really representing over 325 collaborators. But our little program's been pretty successful. Over the past 5 years, we've had 16 major NIH grants, almost $50 million in NIH funding, and quite a few peer-reviewed publications in this new field of translational genomics, the idea of how do you understand whether genomics is actually helping human beings or not. Now, we tend to name our studies, so we try to give them memorable names, and there's a whole bunch of studies here that kind of represent our panoply of research studies. I'm not going to talk about all of them today, but our data that I'm going to show you is sort of drawn from these various studies. I'll start by just saying, reminding you, because in the world of genomics, there is so much talk about the future. We sometimes lose track of what we're doing right now. So here's my little take on what we're using genetic testing for at this very moment in time. And it's mostly diagnosis of rare or undiagnosed conditions, follow-up for newborn screening, abnormalities, limited preconception testing. When you're actually already pregnant, your OBGYN may say, oh yeah, let's test you for cystic fibrosis and one or two other things. Prenatal screening for aneuploidy, that's multiple chromosomes, that's what the new NPI testing that women are getting blood tests for. Pre-symptomatic testing in families with a genetic diagnosis, if you know Huntington disease is running in your family, if you know BRCA mutations are running in your family, the genetics world will test you. And of course, the huge area, I'm not even going to touch on, of therapeutic targets for cancer, which you can glean from sequencing the tumor itself. So this is what we're doing every single day. But you might already think we're doing these next couple of things, but we're not. We are talking in the near future about population sequencing, about the idea that everyone in this room should actually be sequenced. And of course, when you go to your own physician, your physician does not say to you, hey, let's get you sequenced and let's work that into your healthcare plan. It's not really on the radar of most healthcare providers. And even more controversially, newborn sequencing, the idea that we might actually examine the DNA of healthy newborns to see what lies in store for their future health. Prenatal screening using sequencing is something not quite technically feasible now, but very much on the horizon. You can take a blood sample of the pregnant mom and actually isolate the fetal DNA and sequence that. Expanded carrier testing, the notion that before everyone in this room thinks about conceiving a child, they really ought to know what recessive carrier variants they themselves are carrying and their partner are carrying. This is just the easiest way in the world to wipe out whole cadres of devastating diseases in children. And then expanded pharmacogenomics. So ironically, this is where the medical profession is making the most progress, because it's saying, oh yeah, we give drugs. So let's create some sort of system where at the point of care, when a provider is about to prescribe a drug, something pops up and says, oh, my patient could be allergic to this or might require a higher dose of that. So that's making progress, but it's still not in any way uniform. It's still not in any way standard in the practice of medicine across our lives. What is it going to take to get there? And of course, after that, there's going to be gene editing and multi-omics, the idea that we need to talk about way more than just the DNA sequence. We need to talk about the expression of genes, the epigenome. We need to talk about the metabolome, the proteome, the microbiome, and all the different layers of dense information that interact to create the environment that keeps you healthy or makes you sick. But you know, coming back to the genome, it's the first step, and it's the step we understand the best. So my question is, over the last few years, has been, how do we accelerate the implementation of genome sequencing in the day-to-day practice of medicine? What will it take to do that? And the number one thing I think it takes, of course, is evidence that this is the right thing to do. But it's very appealing, right? Because we all want to get to a healthcare system that prevents illness, doesn't just treat illness, but prevents illness. And that's the overall promise of precision health. That's why we're so interested in wearables, in monitoring devices, all the different genetic and non-genetic things that are out there, is that we want to move to healthcare and not sick care. Now, we're very conflicted about DNA. Here's two Time magazine covers. The one on the left says, want to know my future, and sort of implies that by examining the DNA of this baby, you can get a glimpse into the crystal ball of all the different conditions this baby might be heir to. On the right, this other Time magazine cover says, don't believe your DNA. It's really not your destiny. I mean, they're both right. That's the problem. Is there really are future insights within our DNA, but they're largely probabilistic. They're not diagnostic, they're not deterministic. We have to stop thinking about genetic testing as a diagnostic test and start thinking about it as a risk variant, a risk variable, sort of like elevated cholesterol or high blood pressure, something that isn't going to guarantee you to get a disease, but may bring greater attention onto the risk of that disease. Now, as I mentioned, in the clinical realm right now, we are using whole exome testing and whole genome testing largely for just two things, undiagnosed disease and the treatment of cancer. And why aren't we using it more? Well, I've analyzed this a lot, and I think my conclusion is that there are four basic objections or arenas where we have to create evidence to overcome concerns. And these are legitimate concerns. One is that the genetic information itself is toxic. That if I tell you that you have a risk variant for a scary disease, you're going to go right up to the top of this building, go to the roof, and jump off right now, today. And so that's a legitimate concern born, I think, out of the disproportionate experience that early geneticists have had with diseases like Huntington's disease. The other concern is it's just too much information to make sense of. Okay, you're a doctor or you're a patient or a client of a company that gives you genetic risk information. They just give you so much confusing information that it's just overwhelming and you give up. Well, maybe, maybe not. It's kind of like saying, if I give you all the pixels in a chest x-ray, you can't make any sense out of it. It's kind of our job to take a lot of detailed data and somehow coalesce it into a message that a provider can make sense of. There is a genuine concern that participants or providers will actually understand some information, but they'll understand it wrong. They'll misunderstand it, they'll overinterpret it, and they will either fail to take action that needs to be taken, or they will do something, they will overreact and do something wrong. The extreme of this would be somebody misunderstands something that pertains to a BRCA mutation, for example, misunderstands that a variant of uncertain significance is actually pathogenic, and based on that, operates on a woman and does an oophorectomy or mastectomy that actually would not be necessary. That's a legitimate concern, but it is something I think that can be addressed. And I also don't think it's particularly unique to genomics. This kind of thing can happen in all of medicine. And then the sort of more sophisticated, the most sophisticated, I think, concern is a sort of public health notion that assigning people blame, not blame, assigning people risk and letting them live with that risk and all the downstream impact of that risk may actually provide more harm and create more cost than the benefit is worth. So how do we address these things with real evidence to try to see if they are true or not? So the first question, is information toxic? We used a paradigm of returning information for your risk of Alzheimer's disease. You can't get much scarier topic than that. There's absolutely no treatment to definitively slow it down or stop it. So it's untreatable, unstoppable, and yet some people want to know their risk. So we've explored that for over 15 years, and I won't go through all our data except to say here's our data from our flagship paper, which demonstrated that, in fact, the people who volunteered to learn this did very well with the information. They did not have increased anxiety, distress, depression, post-traumatic stress syndrome. They did not do all sorts of inappropriate things with the information. They did, in fact, as you can see here, try to do things like take vitamins, do more exercise. They also, as you can see here on the lower right, reported that they were going to purchase more long-term care life insurance. And this scares the bejesus out of the life insurance and long-term care insurance companies, because this is the kind of thing that if the insurance company doesn't know what you know, you can actually game the system. The people who know they're at risk will buy more insurance. The people who learn they're at less risk will buy less insurance. And that creates something that the insurance companies fear greatly, called adverse selection. So there's definitely stuff happening here, but it is not toxic in the sense that people have been frightened of. Now, the question of whether genetic information is misunderstood is a tough one. We took direct-to-consumer genetic testing as sort of the extreme. Here you are giving genetic information to people without any learned intermediary, without any doctor, without any genetic counselor. What would those people understand or misunderstand? And we ran an entire NIH-funded study in which we looked at the understanding and outcomes of people who learned genetic risk information through direct-to-consumer companies. And again, these are early adopters. They may be more sophisticated, and we're limited by the kinds of things that always limit our research. Who is it that chooses to answer our surveys, whether they're telling the exact truth or not? But as best we could measure it, people's understanding was remarkably good. Now, this is a testament to the legitimate direct-to-consumer companies. Remember, there's a lot of bottom feeders out there doing direct-to-consumer genetics for dating and cosmetics and athletics and things which are not scientifically justified. But the companies that have really put effort in have really tried to communicate this well to people. And you know what, in some cases, they do it better than the doctors and genetic counselors, which is, you know, hard to admit. But it turns out that the understanding is actually quite good. Now, the tougher question is, can we put these in things in a form that a regular provider could use, answering the too much information question? And if we do that, what's the medical, behavioral, and economic outcomes associated with these unanticipated findings if you were to integrate them into the medical profession and into your medical care? Well, to do that, we took a big leap all the way to whole genome sequencing. And we created a project called the MedSeq Project and got funding again from NIH for this, in which we treated all this information just like it was a drug. And we conducted a randomized clinical trial. So we took all of the people we could get to volunteer, randomized them into a group that received the most comprehensive interpretation of their genome we could possibly muster, way, way beyond what is offered today by most laboratories and most commercial vendors. And then the other group who wanted their genome, we said, too bad, tough luck, you're in the placebo group. And we said, but we want to follow you anyway. And they grumbled, but they stayed in the study. And so we followed this out. Now, it's a tough one to do a randomized trial on because you're telling people different things. So let's say this right side of the room is all the people who got your genome. So I'm telling you that we found nothing. I'm telling you that we found a risk variant for a heart problem. I'm telling you in the row behind you that we found a risk problem for a cancer problem. So we're telling you a bunch of different things, but we're trying as a group to find out how you respond, what you understand, what you do with the information. Frankly, just organizing the variant classification was a challenge. I won't go into that, but we've published on that. And creating a method of communication with your primary care doctor was also no easy task. We invented a one-page report. I mean, think about that, a whole genome sequence that we actually generate a one-page report for your doctor, because let's face it, they're not going to want to read any more than that. So this is what our one-page report looks like. It's not fancy. It doesn't have an electronic dashboard. It could. But it basically, we tested the understanding on the even primary care providers, and they did quite well with it. And the real question is, did we find anything useful for this side of the room? And we really did, I think, because we found that 20% of the people on this side of the room were carrying a dominantly inherited monogenic risk variant. And 92% of the people on this side of the room were carrying a recessive carrier variant, which probably won't affect your health, but could affect the health of your children. And 80% of the people on this side of the room are carrying an atypical pharmacogenomic variant for some drug, at least. Maybe not a drug you'll ever see, but wouldn't you like to know before your body sees that drug? And we even did some primitive polygenic risk. Polygenic risk is all the rage right now, but we even did some primitive polygenic risk. And we did it for cardiovascular risk, and we found that the people who are way up here in the long at-risk tail of the polygenic risk, they did things. Their doctors understood the message, and their doctors did things like start them on aspirin, get them extra EKGs, push particularly hard for them to make behavioral changes. So we really did find that a portion of the population, a significant portion of the population, had potentially useful information, and that their doctors paid attention to it. Well, what about costs? We do this cost analysis a lot of different ways because, after all, the trade-off is pretty straightforward. You either generate some early disease prevention and detection, which is worthwhile, is a value to our social system, or you trigger a cascade of medical interventions, some of which could lead to surgery and might even be harmful. So the question is, what's the trade-off here? Tough question to answer in an NIH study that only gives you funding for a couple years, but as best we could tell, in the short term, the people who got whole exome or whole genome sequencing and then all sorts of tests were ordered for them, were slightly but not significantly higher in terms of their downstream medical costs than the people who were in the control group. This is where the strength of a randomized trial, something you don't really think about with the diversity of findings in genomics, really comes in handy, because these are all health-seeking individuals. They all volunteered for this study, but we can show here that the provision of genomic information did not, at least in the short term, explode healthcare costs for these folks. Now, if I've convinced you at all that it's possible that this is a good thing for you as adults, wouldn't it even be a better thing for babies, because you could detect things earlier, particularly pediatric conditions, and you could start treatments and preventive measures earlier? So we, with a great deal of controversy, a great deal of effort, we got funded by NIH to do something called the BabySeq Project, where we actually have been sequencing newborn babies who are ostensibly healthy. And I'm not going to go into a great deal of, because we're still analyzing these data, but here's some early data. Once we got this project through two IRBs and FDA oversight, which, as this photograph suggests, was quite an odyssey, we've been finding some really interesting things. This is just published that out of the 163 newborns we sequenced, with a slightly lesser list of genes than our MedSeq project, so it makes sense that the percentage isn't 20%, came back down to 11%, but still 11% had predictive monogenic findings, stuff we think about as super rare diseases. And of those 11%, if you break them down, we found four kids, or about a quarter of them, who, when we looked more closely, it wasn't just that they were at risk for the condition, we found early evidence of the condition that had not been discovered before. So things that had been missed by well-meaning pediatricians, even by geneticists who had examined them prior to getting in this study, were now discovered once the DNA signal told us to go and look more carefully. Think about that for a second. If that's anywhere near true, that means 11% of healthy newborns are carrying risk for something they could have over the course of their childhood or life, and a quarter of them are already manifesting it in a subclinical, previously undetectable way. I don't know about you, but that blows my mind, because that means we have a tool to discover not just potential disease, but ongoing early disease in these babies. And once again, we examined, because there are many, many concerns about psychological damage, disrupting the family. Once again, we used well-accepted standardized scales, such as the vulnerable baby syndrome. Parents did not express increased distress over their babies. Parents did not demonstrate disrupted mother-infant bonding, which has been one of the concerns. So to sum up, I think there's way more value, even in the genome, much less all these other omes, which are coming down the road, but just in the genome, I think there's way more medical value available to us today than we have been acknowledging. I think that about 91% of us, 92% of us, are carrying recessive carrier traits that we really ought to be looking at before we take on the responsibility of having children. Somewhere between 11 and 18% of us, maybe even as high as 20% of us, are carrying a monogenic risk variant, a dominant mutation for a disease that puts us at risk for that cancer, that heart disease, or that weird rare disease some point in our life. We don't know what percentage of people are going to get it. That's part of the problem. But we know that once you're carrying that mutation, you're at risk for it. About 80% of us are carrying a variant that gives us an atypical reaction to a relatively common drug that we may encounter in our life, and we don't know it now. And about 10 to 20% of us are carrying a constellation of polygenic genes for heart disease, type 2 diabetes, atrial fibrillation, on and on and on, these common complex diseases that are polygenic in nature. And when you take the long tail of those polygenic risk curves, you're picking up 5, 10, 15, 20% of people who are at the same kind of elevated risk as a Mendelian disease risk. That's startling. So I want to conclude there thank you for the opportunity to speak to you and remind you that if you haven't had your own genome sequenced, we have soft launched now the first preventive genomics clinic in the world to provide genome sequencing in a clinical context for adults and children. Now, this is quite controversial. It is medical practice, it's not medical research. Your insurance will not pay for it, so you have to pay out of pocket at this moment in time. But we think that sufficient evidence has accrued to make this a legitimate clinical offering, and we think it's safest and most interesting for you and most efficacious for you to get it embedded in a true clinical context. I also think it may be valuable in a consumer-facing context, and there are companies selling that, including companies that I consult to. But I'm really interested in how this integrates into the day-to-day practice of medicine, so we're trying to model that in this clinic. So I'll stop there, and I'll encourage you to follow us on Twitter, to look at our website, and to contact me with any questions, and check out our new Preventive Genomics Clinic in Boston. Thank you very much.